Cliven Bundy has shied away from the media spotlight since his racist comments became public, but his right-wing militia followers are getting crazier by the minute, and now they've actually turned on each other. Joining me now to talk about the latest development with the Bundy saga is author David Neiwert. You know, David, a psychiatrist could take the DSM-4 and look under delusional kinds of terms, and they would kind of get a picture of what we have working out on the Bundy ranch. You've got these cats that think they're in the midst of the old cowboy days fighting Indians. Another part of them believe that they're playing G.I. Joe, Rambo, militia. It when you look at it, it's almost like delusional children. And you come away thinking, Jesus, it's such childlike analysis of reality that you understand that it has the potential to get out of control, because it's like children with guns, isn't it?
Yeah, a lot of these are folks who, you know, didn't actually pay attention during civics class in high school.
Yeah.
And figured out later that this stuff actually impacts your lives. And so they often attach to a very shallow and sort of superficial approach to politics and government, sort of based on, you know, basically wrapping yourself in a flag. And I think it makes them very susceptible to all kinds of afactual appeals, particularly the conspiracist type, the John Birch Society type, which is really what underlays a lot of this mentality. This is stuff that's been going on for years. You know, I grew up around this stuff in southern Idaho, and it's in a lot of ways, it's almost in the genes.
Yeah, I just started saying, you almost look at it and you say, well, this has got to be in their DNA. Yeah. And it's not, you know, you want all of them, you almost want to say, well, it's just DNA crazy, but really what it is DNA gullible. It's DNA that causes them to get sucked into every kind of conspiracy nut idea that comes along. You know, day one, they're a teabagger. Day two, they're a militiaman. Day three, they're a cowboy riding a horse carrying an American flag across the Bundy ranch. And it's the same mixture. I mean, as much as I read about it, that's my simple conclusion. I don't know how else to put it.
Well, having spent a lot of time with these folks, I can tell you that they're not stupid, which is what a lot of people assume. A lot of them are actually very intelligent, but they have very elaborated worldviews. But these worldviews are predicated on some really foundational problems. And one of them is kind of a paranoid worldview, also a very sort of provincial. So this is what I know, this is what I know of the world, and this is the way the world should work. They're really susceptible to, you talked about their gullibility, but it's a very selective gullibility. Part of the mentality is that they refuse to believe anything that comes from mainstream media or anything, because they think you're being gullible for buying into that, right? So they actually have this very deep skepticism, but it's a very selective skepticism, because they're incredibly gullible for anything that comes along and basically confirms what is already there.
Well, you talk about, David, you talk about their intelligence, but I mean, everybody watching this has sat down with somebody who you might expect to show up at the Bundy Ranch, or might expect to be, you know, dressed up with like George Washington in a teabagger movement. We've all talked to them, and they all, what's I think most aggravating is they give you this aura that they know more than everybody else, that everybody else is simply stupid, that they've looked at something that we haven't seen. It's almost as if they have their secret papers at home and they're able to tell. Now, as you watch this, though, as you cover this story, by the way, your coverage is the only thing that I really rely on. Your coverage on this is excellent, because I think it gets down to these very issues. It's almost like children now who've started fighting among themselves. Talk about that a little bit, how crazy that's become.
Well, right, especially the way they've started, pointing guns at each other and that sort of thing. I mean, a lot of people have suggested that maybe they should just send a drone up over the Bundy Ranch, and that would solve the problem, because they'd all start shooting at each other within a few weeks.
Well, there was an issue where they started fighting among themselves, because there was this conspiracy idea, which was a complete fraud, that Obama had ordered that drones be sent to the Bundy Ranch. I mean, talk about that.
Well, the rumor came around through the Oath Keepers that the Bundy ranch, that Obama had, Eric Holder had signed off on a drone attack on the Bundy ranch. And so the Oath Keepers people, Stuart Rhodes and all of his people, went running into the camp and said, well, we got to, you know, everybody should be prepared for this. And he suggested that a few of his people, particularly a woman with children, should actually leave the camp. Next thing they knew, they were being accused of cowardice. And in fact, I think what
by another faction within the group. In other words, you had the oath. What are they called? The Oath Keepers. And okay.
That was Rhodes and his faction.
Okay, so you got the Oath Keepers now being accused by another faction of desertion or something like that.
Yeah, cowardice, of deserting the field of combat.
Jeez.
Because they wanted, actually, I think they just really wanted to go get a motel room and get a shower.
Yeah. And so what ended up happening was you had the two camps that start pointing fingers and actually pointing guns at each other within the Bundy organization.
Yeah. And they were. And I think this kind of, as you suggest, really reflects the underlying sort of worldview that these guys, they actually have constructed this sort of alternative universe for themselves. I mean, this is something that I described about the Patriot and militia movement back in the 90s, that they basically create this alternative universe of stuff that's not real, but, you know, it's this New World Order conspiracy, and they live in this world where, and everything is self-confirming, and anything that doesn't confirm it is rejected. So, it becomes a sealed off sort of sense of reality. And these people can, you know, when they get wound up enough in that world, they can get violent.
Yeah. David, in this past week, you heard all the Tea Partiers, oh, we're going to have the biggest event in the history of America. Millions are going to come to Washington, D.C. on behalf of people like the Oath Keepers and Cliven Bundy and the Teabaggers and the really frenzy right-wing nuts. All the frenzy right-wing nuts are going to show up in Washington, D.C. Well, there was actually 50 people who actually showed up. And to me, what that is, doesn't that tell you, first of all, the 50 there were really crazy. I mean, these were the nutty of the nuts. But isn't that a message that maybe most Americans do get it about how crazy these people have become? The whole Tea Party movement. I mean, this is Bundy is a reflection of the Tea Party movement. I mean, the Tea Partiers can try to distance themselves. Republicans can try to distance themselves from it. But it is part of their movement. So 50 people show up in Washington, D.C., and you have to wonder, does the rest of the country understand how crazy these nuts are? I mean, is that what's happening here?
The part of the country that's paying attention does. I think that gradually people are starting to reject this stuff. I think that even very conservative people are getting really uncomfortable with how extreme the rhetoric is becoming. And mostly those folks tend to still be in denial about how radical these people are. And this is part of what the continuing aspect of this story that bothers me is that nobody is really, you know, we had a follow-up protest two weekends ago in Utah, also led by the Bundy people, where they went into a site in Utah that was closed off by the BLM, rode in with their ATVs onto this land that was supposed to be protected because these were Indian archaeological sites, and they were trying to stop the archaeological sites from being degraded. But these Bundy protesters, Bundy ranch folks, showed up to back up what was already a local protest there in Utah. And even, you know what, those folks in Utah really wanted nothing to do with the Bundy ranch people. They kind of broke off into separate factions, even at that protest. I think most Americans have enough sense, of course, to understand that this stuff is not right. I think the media needs to start informing people much better in a much more precise fashion just how radical they really are.
Well, here you had, David, you had these lunatics that were stopping people, just regular citizens that happened to live around the Bundy Ranch, told them they couldn't use the public roads, asking them for identification, telling them that they had to turn their car around and go home, that they couldn't drive down a public road. And the media yawned. The media, corporate media at least, acted like that wasn't important. I mean, really?
Well, yeah, I know. Actually, I'll say the local media went out and checked it out, and they couldn't find any evidence that those roadblocks were going on. But a lot of the local residents there were actually talking to their congressmen and saying that they had been stopped by these guys. And sure enough, after a while, a few photos turned up of people being stopped at these roadblocks. So we know that they were occurring. The militiamen denied that they were doing this. But either way, I agree. You know, just the fact that they were doing that should have caught a lot of people's attention.
As you
after the standoff, the media yawned and moved on to the next story.
Yeah, as you point out in this story, it's not over for the real kooks. The FBI is on it. They've got pictures of them. They've got films. They'll quietly take care of this after the Bundy excitement goes on. David Neiwert, as usual, Southern Poverty Law Center, you're a great writer for them. Mark Potok, Morris Dees, all the friends of mine that I'm always amazed at how they see things that corporate media simply ignores. Thank you for joining me, okay?
Thank you, Mike. I should also mention my colleague Ryan Lenz, who's been doing a lot of the coverage.
Oh, yes, for sure, for sure. Well, thanks a lot. Bye-bye. David Neiwert is the author of the book, And Hell Followed With Her.